गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर योगेश सरोदे ऑफ जीवन विकास महाविद्यालय देवग्राम। आई हार्टी वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस सेशन। टुडे वी विल लर्न अबाउट द पोयम द हाईवे मैन कंपोज्ड बाय अल्फ्रेड नोएस। इन द अर्लियर पार्ट वी हैड सीन द सेंट्रल आइडिया ऑफ द पोयम अबाउट अल्फ्रेड नोएस, theme of the poem and the central idea of the poem also. So today we will carry out the reading part and we'll see the comprehension also. So once again I will repeat the earlier. The Highwayman is a narrative poem written and first published in August 1906 issue of a Blackwood's magazine based in Edinburgh, Scotland. The poem is set in 18th century England and tells the story of a highwayman in love with Bess, a landlord's daughter. Their love story is ill-fated and ultimately both of them die. We learn in the latter stanzas that the ghost of the lovers meet again on winter nights. Noyes displays his skill at writing narrative poetry, reminiscent of his two biggest influences, Wordsworth and Tennyson. So, as far as poem is concerned, the poem, The Highwayman, is a three-part poem, and that is divided into one set of six stanzas, another of nine stanza, and a final concluding two stanza section. So the poem is in three parts. First part is of six stanza, second part is of nine stanza, and third part is of two stanza. The stanzas are all six lines long, known as sestet. You know, sestet follow a simple rhyme scheme of AA, BC, CB, changing end sounds from stanza to stanza as the poet thinks fit. The meter is a little more complicated. There are six set of two beats per line, known as hexameter, but the stress or emphasis moves from line to line. So we'll carry out the reading of the poem. Listen carefully. See the first stanza of part one. You will find a poem of some narrative type. The wind was a torrent of darkness among the gusty trees. The moon was a ghostly galleon tossed upon cloudy seas. The road was a ribbon of moonlight over the purple moor, and the highwayman came riding. Riding, the highwayman came riding up to the old inn door. This is the first stanza. Now, second stanza. He had a French cocked hat on his forehead, a bunch of lace at his chin, a coat of the claret velvet, and breeches of brown doe skin. They fitted with never a wrinkle. His boots were up to the thigh, and he rode with a jeweled twinkle, his pistol butts a twinkle, his rapier hilt a twinkle under the jeweled sky. Now see the third stanza. Over the cobbles he clattered and clashed in the dark in air, and he tapped with his whip on the shutters, but all was locked and barred. He whistled a tune to the window, and who should be waiting there but the landlord's black-eyed daughter, Base, the landlord's daughter, plaiting a dark red love knot into her long black hair. Fourth stanza. And dark in the old inn yard, a stable wicket creaked, where Tim the ostler listened. His face was white and peaked. His eyes were hollows of madness. His hair like moldy hay. But he loved the landlord's daughter, the landlord's red-lipped daughter. Dumb as a dog he listened, and he heard the robber say. This is fourth stanza. Now see, fifth one. One kiss, my bony sweetheart, I am after a prize tonight, but I shall be back with the yellow gold before the morning light. Eight, if they press me sharply and harry me through the day, then look for me by moonlight, watch for me by moonlight. I will come to thee by moonlight, though hell should bar the way. Fifth one. This is fifth stanza. Now sixth. He rose upright in the stirrups. His care could reach her hand, but she loosened her hair. Eighth casement. His face burnt like a brand, as the black cascade of perfume came tumbling over his breast, and he kissed its waves in the moonlight. Oh, sweet black waves in the moonlight. Then he tugged at his rein in the moonlight and galloped away to the west. This is first part. Now see, second part of the poem. First stanza. He did not come in the dawning. He did not come at noon. And out over the towny sunset, before the rise over the moon, when the road was a gypsy ribbon looping the purple moor, a red coat troop came marching, marching, marching. King George's men came marching up to the old inn door. Second stanza. They said no word to the landlord. They drank his ale instead, but they gagged his daughter and bound her to the foot of her narrow bed. Two of them knelt at her casement with muskets at their side. There was death at every window and hell at one dark window, for Bess could see through the casement the road that he would write. Third stanza. They had tied her up to attention with many a sniggering jest. They bound a musket beside her with the barrel beneath her breast. Now keep good watch, and they kiss her. She heard the dead man say, look for me by moonlight, watch for me by moonlight. I shall come to thee by moonlight, though hell should bar the way. This is the third one. Now fourth. She twisted her hands behind her, but all the knots held good. She wreathed her hands till her fingers were wet with sweat or blood. They stretched and strained in the darkness, and the hours crawled by like years, till now on the stroke of midnight, cold on the stroke of midnight, the tip of one finger touched it. The trigger at least was hers. Now, fifth one. The tip of one finger touched it. She strove no more for the rest. Up, she stood up to attention with the barrel beneath her breast. She would not risk their hearing. She would not strive again. For the road lay bare in the moonlight, blank and bare in the moonlight, and the blood of her veins in the moonlight throbbed to her love's refrain. Sixth stanza. Clot, 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 had they heard it, the horse hoofs ringing clear. Clot, 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 in the distance, were they deaf that they didn't not hear? Down the ribbon of moonlight, over the brow of the hill, the highwayman came riding, riding, riding. The red coats looked to their priming. She stood up straight and still. Now, seventh stanza. Clot, clot in the frosty silence. Clot, clot in the echoing night. Nearer he came and nearer. Her face was like a light. Her eyes grew wide for a moment. She drew one last deep breath. Then her finger moved in the moonlight. Her musket shattered the moonlight. Shattered her breast in the moonlight and warned him with her death. Eighth part, eighth stanza. He turned his spur to the waist. He didn't come to stood. Bowed with her head over the musket, drenched with her own red blood. Not till the dawn he heard it. His face grew grey to hear. How base, the landlord's daughter, the landlord's black-eyed daughter, had watched for her love in the moonlight and died in the darkness there. Ninth stanza. Back he spurred like a mammon, shrieking a curse to the sky. With the white road smoking behind him and his rapier brandished high, blood red where his spurs is the golden noon, wine red was his velvet coat. When they shot him down on the highway, down like a dog on the highway, and he lay in his blood on the highway with a bunch of lace at his throat. And see now, third part, that is first stanza. And still of a winter's night, they say, when the wind is in the trees, when the monsoon is ghostly gallant tossed upon cloudy seas, when the road is a ribbon of moonlight over the purple moor, a highwayman comes riding, 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 a highwayman comes riding up to the old inn door. And now, last stanza of part 3. Over the cobbles he clatters and clangs in the dark inn yard, and he taps with his whip on the shutters, but all is locked and barred. He whistles a tune to the window, and who should be waiting there but the landlord's black-eyed daughter, base, the landlord's daughter, planting a dark red love knot into her long black hair. And here in this long poem. So friends, in this part, I have tried to carry out the reading so that there should be a proper understanding of the poem. In the next session, we will see the compression part of this poem. So thank you. Good day.